in New York, and we continue our Beach Boy Labor Day weekend special with this interview with Dennis Wilson. And it starts off with a question about the gentleman we heard from just a little while ago. Let's talk about Brian for a bit. There is no question in my mind that for a very long period, the Beach Boys served as the vehicle for his musical vision. But it seemed as if that stopped with a thud right around the Smiley Smile period. What happened, Dennis?
I don't know.
You lived it. You must have some.
It's really hard to make a judgment. I think that it was drugs. You know, his doctor thought it was drugs. And at the time he was doing drugs. Everyone was doing drugs. But certain people can handle certain drugs and other people can't. And I think that's exactly what happened.
Now, Brian had shown evidence of personal problems even before the drugs, correct? There was an ear thing?
Well, yeah, an ear thing, but I don't think that had anything to do with the psychological problem.
Okay, there was an episode that supposedly took place in December of 64, which would put it right around the...
They stopped touring, you're talking about.
Right, right. Apparently, you were on a plane.
I think he was doing drugs then. If I remember correctly, I think there were drugs. I was busy with messing around with the girls during spare time.
Well,
I'm not sure. I know that there was a problem and he didn't want to travel. I remember that I think it was either in Houston or Dallas. I saw him crying in his room and he said he didn't want to go on the road anymore. You know?
Well, at that point, it almost seemed as if there were two things going on. There were the performing Beach Boys carrying the message and vision of the group to the concert halls around America and around the world. And then there was Brian back home in his room or in a sandbox in his living room at the piano or whatever the particular legend was, creating heretofore unheard sounds on rock and roll records, pet sounds, if you will, smile sounds, if you will. Not only was there pressure from the record company to return to a successful formula that had worked for half a decade before, but it seemed to me, and I read on occasion, that the band was uptight about it as well.
Mm-hmm. The band was uptight about Pet Sounds?
About the direction that the group's music
That's
was taking.
Are you kidding?
Would you say that...
Right. Are you kidding? We would be in the studio, and he'd play us a song. We'd start singing. We'd start crying. It was so great. It was like, how could this possibly be happening? How'd you write that? And whoever told you that was being humble. Was that Brian telling you that?
Well, I heard it more than once.
Well, if you heard more than once, that's interesting.
That there was a fight for control within the group to get back to a... more commercial hit-making formula.
There's not one person in the group that could come close to Brian's talent. I couldn't imagine who the fight would be. Would it be my father? No.
Didn't he withdraw? How do you fire your dad?
You say, Dad, I'll see you later, you know.
Why? Did you think that he just had...
got tired of $100 fines for swearing.
Oh, he was into that sort of discipline.
He was wonderful. I mean, he loved it, but sometimes you outgrow the need of the fatherly support. You've got to cut that off.
Can you appreciate the perception that after the Smiley Smile album, expectations were high, and instead here was an album that was so rudimentary?
I think the only letdown of the Beach Boys' career that embarrassed me through and through was the 2020 album.
Why?
Because it was the first album the group made that was completely disjointed. We had to find things that Brian had worked on and try and piece it together. And, you know, that's where there was no involvement at all.
Okay, so in a sense, you're saying that...
That's when things started to happen.
And it wasn't because you didn't want Brian to participate, but rather because he couldn't or wouldn't.
I would go to his house daily and beg, what can I do to help you? I said... Forget recording. Forget all of it. It got to Brian's health. You know. And then, as the Beach Boys were slowly slipping away, You know, we're at home trying to take care of our brother. That's what happened.
Why were the Beach...
I'd give up everything, just as long as my brother would be okay. I'm sure you'd be... You know that feeling of being a family person yourself.
Sure. The problem is, though, that that there are expectations on the part of your audience.
Right. Well, and on we paid that price, you know. Beach Boys...
You'd become big business. Beach Boys were big business, too.
And then we became no business. I remember coming to New York. They, you know, they offer us $2,000 or $3,000 for a show, and maybe we could get 3,000 or 4,000 people. You know,
yeah,
it really got to a terrible place. You know?
Let's talk for a minute about the aborted tour with the Maharishi.
That was aborted because Martin Luther King got shot and killed, right in the same city where we were playing the same night. That ended the tour.
Was it not also true, however, that there were...
Well, the National Guard ended it. We were setting up our instruments, and they moved in with jeeps and guns. That was it. No, I loved playing on that tour. It was wonderful to be with that man.
Weren't there a lot of empty seats, and weren't there a lot of negative reactions from the audience?
That was to be expected, but it was...
Why?
Well, at that time, to talk about spiritual enlightenment versus, try some of this, you know... Who knows? I don't really care. But there were empty seats. But at least it got something going. It started. I'm very happy to have Brian on stage with us now, you know.
That must be... It was such a trip to see him standing there the other night.
Oh, God, it's so wonderful. When he walked across the stage, just walked, and the people applauded. That makes me feel good. It makes the 6 years that he was hurting and suffering, you know, people didn't really understand sometimes... People are afraid to look at someone that may have a mental problem. It's a lot easier to turn your back. But if you're forced to be there and live with him, and you watch the progress, it's very slow, but when it starts to happen, I'm the happiest guy in the world.
What was the turning point?
Except for my hangover. What?
What was the turning point for Brian?
In a good sense or the bad sense?
In the positive sense.
Well... I think Brian had enough. I think Brian turned himself. I don't believe that a doctor or a wife or a brother can actually make somebody change. I think it had to come from within himself.
But it was certainly instigated or helped along by...
I think he had enough. It can only be that. Because he had to create his problem. Like you'd have to create the love you might feel for someone, right? Or, you have, in your mind, if you're upset, you have to make that upsetness, create that. And I think it was time, he had the time where he created, well, I might get better, you know? But I believe he was really sick. I mean, it was terrible. I mean, there's things that, I can sit and tell you atrocity stories of things that have happened to Brian, or, you know, it's crazy. But he made it back. The turning point was Brian making an attempt to seek help.
Did you ever have the feeling that it was like the old cliche about the family that has the crazy uncle locked up in a room upstairs and they try not to...
Look, you want to know something? I thought it was permanent brain damage. That's how I was living for a while. That was frightening. To think that somebody that you love very much will be permanently damaged. And I'm sure when you sat with Brian the other day here, you might have had that same thought, that he could have been really hurt.
I'll tell you very honestly.
I mean, I really have been frightened, but to see the progress, you know that it's not that way.
Meeting and talking with him the other day, I left with the feeling that I'm not convinced either way as to what's ahead in the future.
If you would have sat with him over a year ago, you'd have been convinced that he was permanently ruined. It's phenomenal the way he is.
Yeah, it really gives the people who care about him... And
it takes a lot of guts for a guy like Brian to be in his... To come back, to put himself in the public that way and come back. I think he's going to help a lot of people in that way, too, to come back. Because I think there are a lot of people in the world today that are hurting, you know?
It seems at times, though, as if he's programmed by others.
I think that he's programming others. He's very clever.
being as close to him as you obviously are, you were in a better position.
He's so clever that it's amazing. In the studio, you've got to live with someone on a day-to-day basis, and you start picking up little things, you know.
What was Brian's role, if any, on the albums from Wild Honey prior to 15 Big Ones?
He wrote, he sang, and he produced.
But just in snippets, yes?
Yes, whenever he felt like he wanted to.
And it was really left to the rest of the members of the band to kind of fill in the missing blanks here and there. His production credit was missing, really, from a number of those albums.
He wanted it that way. He said, it's produced by the Beach Boys.
See, that harkens back to that thing I mentioned earlier, to an audience that is not a Wilson brother, or a relative, or lives with the band on a day-to-day basis the year round, it really seemed as if his efforts were being de-emphasized in favor of each of you as individuals coming forth and producing a track, producing the songs that you contributed.
If anyone in the group wanted to produce something, they can come down and do anything they want. They can put it out on their own, or if somebody wrote a song and wanted to put it on the album, they could. That game is not played with this group. The group would prefer to have Brian do it all, to write, because we love his music, only because we love his music. Not because there's a lack of talent or a weakness. It's just that we really love his music, like I'm sure a lot of Brian's public.
That is truly one of the nicest things on Dennis Wilson's solo album, Pacific Ocean Blue. And it's called River Song. Before that, Dennis sharing some really rather frank and poignant observations about his brother and the band.
Very loud monitors. We're going to do 107, Ron.